Everyone, I am Ashley Johnson, the Administrative Coordinator for the SES RCD program, and I would like to welcome you to our first webinar on psychosocial health disparities among cancer patients, understanding the influence of race, ethnicity, and SES on mental health service utilization. We are very excited about this topic and glad you are able to join us today. We will first start with a brief overview of the SES RCD program by the program manager, Shalini Parikh. We will then have Dr. Kathy Kanal present on psychosocial health disparities among cancer patients, and at the end, we will open the floor for questions. Thank you again for joining us.
Hello. Thank you for joining us on this webinar, and thank you for the introduction, Ashley. My name is Shalini Parekh, and I am the Program Manager for the Socioeconomic Status-Related Cancer Disparities Program, which sponsored this webinar. Before we begin the topic of our webinar, I did want to take just a few minutes of your time to talk a little bit about this program, just so all of you are aware that we do exist. And we are eager to collaborate and offer our services to the cancer community at large. The program seeks to strengthen the capacity of community cancer-serving organizations and stakeholders to utilize evidence-based strategies that improve cancer prevention, early detection, and survivorship in socioeconomically disadvantaged populations. A question I often get is, what are community cancer-serving organizations? And the simple answer is, they're normally nonprofit organizations in hospitals. Our program is nestled within the American Psychological Association under the Public Interest Directorate, which fulfills APA's commitment to apply psychology to the problems of human welfare and promotion of equitable and just treatment of all segments of society. Under that is the Office of Socioeconomic Status, which has received the grant from the Centers for Disease Control, which has made this program possible. The SES RCD program structure has three main components. On the left is the BSSV program, in the middle is the workshops that we conduct, and on the right are our online forums. I'm going to begin right now talking a little bit about the workshops. They're conducted around the country in collaboration with state health departments, cancer collaborators, and cancer coalitions, and also other stakeholders such as the American Cancer Society. Our workshops are opportunities for community cancer-serving organization professionals to get together and learn about the latest evidence-based strategies in intervening on cancer prevention and survivorship in their community. We have collaborated with organizations around the country, and our workshop materials begin with sort of an introduction about disparities that exist around the country. This is one of the slides that we do show during our workshop that shows U.S. cancer incidence by mortality, in mortality by race. And we really like to underline the importance that socioeconomic status influences the prevalence of behavioral risk factors, and it really is the single greatest predictor of health status. We also talk a little bit about how the higher an individual's education level is, the lower their cancer incidence is, and also how income also influences cancer incidence. Our workshops also cover social determinants of health, including topics such as neighborhoods, social factors, and psychological factors. We also close our workshop by talking about sources of evidence-based interventions that organizations can use in their communities. A lot of these sources are found online, but a lot of these organizations don't know about them. Now I'd like to talk a little bit about the mini grants that come out of our workshop. They are meant for individuals who have participated in our workshop. Any 501(c) cancer-serving organization or medical center can apply. And to date, our program has awarded 50 mini-grants of up to $5,000 each. I would love to go through all of the projects that we're currently funding, but here's a small example of some of the organizations that we have funded with, thanks to the funding made available by the CDC. A lot of the target populations that these projects work with are minority communities and low SES populations, and we do strive to get quite a diversity in the populations that are worked with by the nonprofits that receive our funding. Next, I'd like to talk about our BSSB program, which is a national network of behavioral and social scientists that provide free evidence-based capacity-building assistance to community cancer-serving organizations. To date, we've provided 25 SES RCD BSSBs have provided free evidence and guidance to community cancer-serving organizations. Who are BSSBs? They're field professionals that are psychologists, public health scientists, sociologists, anthropologists, and they're experts in community behavioral interventions. They're committed to eliminating health disparities in cancer through community-based interventions. We have over 60 of these individuals on staff that are ready and willing to work with any community-based organization located around the country. They are able to assist with a number of assistance requests, such as adapting evidence-based interventions, supporting advocacy and policy efforts, designing assessments, creating grant writing assistance and reviews, and also designing project monitoring and evaluation plans. The truth is, the possibilities for requests are not limited to what is listed above. It's really endless. Again, I wish I could talk a little bit about each of the assistance that our program has delivered, but this is some examples of organizations located around the country and the BSSBs our program has matched them with, and the assistance that was provided by those BSSBs. The assistance has ranged from guidance on outreach strategies with various ethnic and minority groups, to grant technical reviews, to the development of community needs assessments. In order to receive assistance, any cancer-serving organization can contact our program. Our staff then locates the appropriate BSSB based on location, expertise, and experience, and then both the BSSB and cancer-serving organization agree to set deliverables in a memorandum of agreement. And if you would like to become a BSSB, you're welcome to contact our staff. We're looking for any professionals who would be interested in joining our wonderful program. And finally, to end my short presentation, I'd like to talk a little bit about our online forum. Our program has what we call the National Translation and Dissemination Network, which is a place where all participants in our workshops and our BSSBs gather together to exchange information and to talk about the projects that they currently have going on in their communities and through their organizations. Our staff also posts upcoming articles, grant information, and other topically interested topics on this website. So in total, our program has a number of capacities where we really try to reach out and build the strength of community-based organizations located around the country. For more information, I encourage all of you to visit our home on the web. The website is provided above. And if you would like some more specific information, you're welcome to contact our staff. My name again is Shalini Parekh, and I would be happy to speak to anybody on more information about our program. Now it's time for me to pass, the mouse on to our presenter. Her name is Kathy Canole, and she's coming to us from California. Kathy, you should be getting, should be able to log on right now.
There I think go. I'm there. Can you see my screen?
I can.
Great. Am I good to go, Shalini?
Yes, you're good to go.
All right. Well, welcome everybody, and thank you for taking the time today to listen to this topic. It's a very important one, I think, and it's just unfortunate that in a short amount of time we can't do justice to it, but at least we can begin to...
Kathy, I'm sorry, I can't hear you very well.
Okay, is that better?
Yes, that is.
Okay, I'm going to hold this much better. Okay, is that a little bit better?
Yes, it is.
Okay, great. Well, again, thank you all for being here. So in the short amount of time that we have together, I'm going to try to at least raise some of the issues that are important, I think, in understanding the psychosocial, I guess, ramifications of having a diagnosis of cancer for ethnically diverse populations and individuals who are of low socioeconomic status. And that, in essence, is the gist of this webinar today. So, you know, it seems obvious that somebody's emotional well-being would be affected by a diagnosis of cancer, but sometimes I think the energy is placed into, of course, taking care of the physical demands that are so important that one's emotional needs are put on the shelf for a little bit. And so I think it's really important when we talk about addressing these psychosocial needs that we not forget that there are groups of individuals who are still at a significant disadvantage in even accessing that care, and that there are real consequences to having a diagnosis of cancer. And in order to enhance the quality of life for individuals, you can't ignore these psychological factors, and particularly so for vulnerable groups. I'm also going to talk briefly about some of the strategies that we can implement to improve care for everyone, but also for, of course, our target groups, those who are at a particular disadvantage. And we'll talk about why that disadvantage occurs. If at any point you're having a hard time hearing me, Charlene or anybody, just you can let me know, okay? When I was trying to do research on this topic, I was attempting to put all together all this literature, and I thought somewhere along the way that I would find that there would be one article that would address the psychosocial needs of our ethnically diverse population here in the United States. Now, that would provide me with sufficient information to put together this webinar. What I found was that there's not a whole lot of research, and you know, and maybe my skills aren't that good at you know, identifying some of this topic, some of the issues in this topic. But what struck me was some of the information that I did come across, and that is over 10.5 million people in the U.S. will have a diagnosis of cancer at some point, have had or will have, and that 1 in 10 households will be affected, and that if we live long enough, about 41% of us at some point in our lives will have a diagnosis of cancer. And in addition to dealing with these physical challenges, we're going to face a multifaceted experience of life-altering concerns. And cancer affects the whole person, not just the particular, you know, the body, the physical aspects of that. And again, it seems common sense, but let's talk about it a little bit more. When you're faced with a potentially life-threatening disease, the way you look at the world changes, I think. And some of you don't have to imagine that. Some of you have experienced that, I'm sure. There's a lot of stress and worry that goes with the diagnosis, and concerns about what's going to happen to me, what's going to happen to my physical abilities, what are some of the longer-term consequences, and also concerns about our own mortality. We're also very worried about our family members, what may become of them, or how are they experiencing my illness, and also just plain identity and body image issues. When I talk about identity, it's having to look at yourself in a new way, or maybe not being able to fulfill the duties that you felt are part of who you are, and that can create a lot of anxiety and stress for you, as well as any kind of body changes that may occur. And you begin to look at yourself a little bit differently, perhaps, and that can create additional distress. One of the reasons, well, probably the most important reason why we want to address the emotional aspects of having a diagnosis of cancer, this is for the population as a whole, and a lot of the information that I've gotten came out of Cancer Care for the Whole Patient, which is a wonderful summary of some of the psychosocial issues faced by cancer patients, and you'll have that reference at the end. So if we are able to manage some of the worry and stress in our life, and some of the psychological distress that comes along with having an illness, then we're going to be better physically and stronger to deal with, you know, the treatment plan, with the changes that occur in our lives. So we have to, in addition to dealing with the physical challenges of cancer, we got to try to be in a place where we can manage those stressors so we can be stronger and less vulnerable to the disease itself. It's armoring yourself. It's being able to fight back. And you can do that better if you've got your stress managed. I mean, you can't eliminate it, but managing it certainly is a good place to start.
Kathy, this is Shalini. Your voice keeps going in and out. I just wonder if maybe this needs to be a little closer to your mouth. I'm not sure. I just wanted to.
Okay, I'm holding it. I'm also going to raise it. Is that better?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you for letting me know. Zamora in 2001 found that, I mean, we're getting clearly close to a quarter of cancer patients were expressing significant psychological stress in one of their comprehensive studies of over, it was close to 5,000 people. What they found is that people were significantly affected, and not just the worry, but in many other ways. And studies showed that a number of adults and children, children cancer patients, as well as the cancer, as well as the parents of children with cancer, showed symptoms of PTSD. It's as if you are blindsided in your life, where you get, all of a sudden you receive this diagnosis and life is not the way it's supposed to be for you or for your children. And the consequences are so significant that in fact you can develop post-traumatic stress disorder, just being highly anxious and concerned about your illness. I want to make sure that I'm not missing anything here. So that you can see that it's, you know, the resulting stress of being diagnosed can create a problem in and of itself. But let's just say that you were not even, you didn't meet the criteria for clinical diagnosis. Even without that, it's important to address the worry and fear associated with having cancer to ensure that people are living the best quality life that they can. Nicole Springer is a researcher who does a lot of work with Latinas in breast cancer. And she found that almost half of them, depending upon the study, experience a wide range of behavioral and emotional concerns, ranging from things like just basic pain management and the stress associated with that, to issues like, you know, things you wouldn't necessarily think about, sexual dysfunction, concerns about mortality, body image, persistent intrusive thoughts, a sense of being vulnerable to the world is not a safe place for you, communication issues with their partner, fears of being rejected by their partner. So again, it stands to reason that one should begin to at least talk about some of the ramifications of having a diagnosis of cancer. This is again for people in general. Why we want to look specifically at some of the vulnerabilities of our ethnic groups is that they are particularly, there are unique stressors associated with having cancer and being an ethnic minority or somebody from lower socioeconomic status in the United States. And they coincide with some of these four categories of vulnerability that Napoleon Springer talks about. So what is your risk in terms of, you know, what to what degree might you develop significant emotional distress or even a psychological disorder in addition to having a cancer diagnosis? Well, there are four categories that she identifies as being you know, where you could be at greater risk. And many of our ethnic populations, and particularly people who are of lower socioeconomic status, are especially vulnerable in these areas. So we look at the biological and physiological limitations of individual who has cancer. The longer you've had it, the earlier the age of diagnosis, and the severity of the illness will put you at greater risk for developing emotional distress. Having to deal with a chronic long-term problem, of course, is going to naturally create additional stressors for you.
Kathy,
if you, yes.
I hate to interrupt. Several people are emailing saying they're not able to hear very well, and I think it's the microphone.
Okay.
And I think if you use your phone, it'll come through a little bit louder.
Okay.
So what we're going to have you do is call with your telephone, call the number, and basically log back in using the access code that you have in your email.
Okay, so log out.
Do you still have that?
I should have the – I should go right back to that. So you just give me a couple minutes. I'm so sorry.
That's okay. You can stay on this screen. You don't have to exit your PowerPoint.
Okay.
And she doesn't have to log out, I don't think. Can she just call in?
I thought that was good. Yeah, I can just call
in. Yeah, she can just call in. She doesn't have to log out.
Okay.
Yeah, and Kathy, I can send you the phone number.
Okay, so you're going to send that to me?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You can do it through the chat thingy here?
Sure.
Okay, I'll go grab my phone. Yeah, kind of with my phone in hand, just looking for.
Kathy, are you still on?
Yes, I am.
I just sent you the number. We apologize to all our listeners for this.
Yes, I do apologize.
Just want to make sure all of you can hear this wonderful presentation, and it should just take another second or two.
I'm looking for an audio pin. Do you have that?
Will she need that, Cynthia?
It's requesting.
Yes.
I do apologize, everyone. We'll get on the chat.
I found my audio pin is no longer showing.
Hold up. It's 303-556.
I can hear you through the phone.
Okay, there it is. 303-556-579.
Okay. Can you all hear me?
Yes. Is that through your phone?
Yes, it's through my phone.
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, you can continue. Thank you.
Okay. And can the participants hear me?
They're not going to be able to respond. Or
yeah, they should be able to hear you.
Okay. I'm good to go?
Yes.
Okay. You can all right, well, let me know. I apologize to everyone. All right. So we left off in looking at the four categories of vulnerability. And we talked about the biological and physiological limitations. And poor psychological coping is also an area of greater risk and vulnerability. Am I coming through okay?
I just want to double check.
Kathy?
Yes.
If your microphone is still on, can you unplug it? There's a little bit of an echo.
Okay. I'm sorry.
That's okay. I think that should clear it.
Is that better?
Say testing again.
Testing. What is that echo?
Ask. Can you mute your speaker on your computer?
Okay. I think it's muted.
Okay.
Okay, and it says I'm, can you hear me?
Yes, that's perfect. Thank you.
Is that better?
Yes.
Okay, good. All right. And everybody can hear me, I hope.
It's a lot better.
Okay. So I was talking about the poor psychological coping. And one becomes vulnerable when you already have pre-existing conditions that may be affecting the additional diagnosis of cancer. So, for example, if you already have high stress levels or you have an existing depression even before you're diagnosed, and those things are going to make you particularly more vulnerable in terms of getting the help that you need.
Social deficits, your ability to communicate well and communicate your needs are very important when you're struggling with an illness. Being able to communicate with those you love, being able to communicate with your healthcare provider, being able to disclose that you are having, you know, emotional distress is really important. And some people are better at doing that than others. And also having social support. We know that having somebody in your life that you can talk to is extremely important just in terms of your longevity. People live longer when they have good, healthy social support, and particularly when you're vulnerable and you're ill. It's really important to get that help. Additionally, resource limitations, how much you're able to know about your disease and have access to information, as well as your educational level, as Charlene was pointing out earlier in the slides, it's really, they're correlated in terms of your, incidence rates as well as mortality rates. And then, you know, without question, the financial aspects of having resources, so having insurance, having, best money to get the best care possible, all things are going to be correlated with, you know, better outcomes in terms of your diagnosis. And I was thinking about today, even in the news, we're, you know, listening to the limited amount of drugs that are available for all kinds of treatments. So even if you did have money, in terms of resource limitations, if it, not enough of particular medications are being produced, then you're at a disadvantage. And that's going to create stress for you. If you don't have access to the things that you need, you're going to become more vulnerable. All right. Let's see if I switch that over. What we find also in the research and literature is that low-income and underserved patients, cancer patients, have less access to mental health services in general. So if you're barely getting your physical needs met, the likelihood that you're going to have access to counseling and support groups and therapy is diminished if you're from a lower economic status. And that we also recognize that there are significant racial and ethnic disparities that exist in healthcare service and outcomes, where when you look at the research studies, you're finding that minorities are receiving less care and endure more suffering in terms of their illness. Additionally, minorities are disproportionately represented among the poor, unemployed, and undereducated. And it's this lower socioeconomic status that's correlated with less access to healthcare services in general. Interestingly, though, even those minorities who do not have that economic disadvantage still are experiencing a disparate healthcare system care in terms of that healthcare. I was going to give you an example about what we see in terms of overdiagnosis of the more severe types of psychological issues for African American and Latino communities. And it's that discrepancy between the healthcare practitioner and the patient, that greater the cultural divide, the more likely you're going to see misdiagnosis and not the best forms of treatment for the patient. And if we look at some of the cross-cultural studies in terms of how patients experience the distress associated with cancer, there's not a whole lot out there. What I found is in terms of a lot of work with maybe more Latinas and African Americans, and myself, I'm of Mexican descent, so, you know, if I were to speak for my own culture, and you can use these as examples for all the cultures that we have, each one may distinctly express their distress in different ways. So if we look, for example, at Latina breast care survivors, and you compare them to Western European or white breast cancer survivors in terms of psychological distress, you begin to see differences. So Latinas will report greater concerns over recurrence, greater degrees of pain, concerns about death, concerns about their body image and sexual functioning. They will have greater job disruptions, more significant financial hardships, greater weight gain, and feeling like they're being rejected by their husbands more as compared to white breast cancer survivors. So when we begin to look within the cultures or compare cultures, experiences are not equal. There's a wonderful resource that I would encourage all of you to have and read if you're interested in this topic and you want to go into it into greater depth, and that's the Surgeon General Report. It's a supplement to the Surgeon General Report, but it specifically addresses issues of mental health related to culture, race, and ethnicity. And it's free. It's an online book that's free, and you also have that reference in the end, or you can reach us, and we'll be able to show you where to find that. But it's just an outstanding research. It's based on research looking at healthcare and mental health, more specifically for ethnic minorities. So anyway, the report defines mental illness as an interaction among biological, psychological, social, and cultural factors. It's not just this one, there's not one variable involved in determining mental illness. It's just a multitude of factors that can exacerbate somebody who's already predisposed to having a particular disorder. And when we look at ethnic and racial minorities here in the United States, according to the Surgeon General report, that we're finding that they're living in social and economic conditions that are not equal, and that they include stressors like discrimination and racism, violence and poverty, and that this stress itself affects mental health. Living in poverty increases the likelihood of having a mental disorder 2 to 3 times. That's not to say that because you're poor, you're going to become mentally ill, and that needs to be stated very clearly, because that relationship, we know that there's a relationship that exists between poverty and mental illness. What is not as clear is what causes what. Now, we know that living in poverty causes extreme stress, and that having extreme stress will make you vulnerable to emotional distress and disorders, but also having an existing emotional disorder or psychiatric diagnosis will put you in a position of not being able to maintain employment, and that'll also lower your economic status. So it's kind of like a chicken and the egg problem. I want to make sure that it's clear that, you know, being poor in and of itself is stressful, but it's not the only determinant, and that you're not likely to think that somebody is poor because they're poor, they are mentally ill, and I just want to be very careful in being able to address that. The United States is a very diverse country, becoming ever more diverse, you know, year after year. And I think it's an old-fashioned way of categorizing our cultural populations into 4 groups. So that's where most of the research is right now. And I think and I hope that in the future we're going to be able to address all of the different cultures, at least clusters of cultures that we can find. But for right now, we still are looking at the 4 major ethnic groups in the United States. And in terms of their experiences with health and mental health services, I'm going to quickly go through this, I know, because we had some of the delays with time, so I apologize if I'm rushing through this. So when we look at African Americans as a whole, and everybody's different and every case is different, but if we're going to look at the population, this population as a whole, then we can see that African Americans carry a disproportionate heavy burden of health problems and higher mortality rates, especially cancer, and have less access to health services. 25% of African Americans are uninsured. And when they do get mental health services or counseling or psychosocial services, it tends to be when problems become way more complicated. So they're less likely to get that proactive approach. If they're having emotional consequences related to a diagnosis of cancer, they're more likely to talk about it with their doctor. And it's going to be up to the doctor to be savvy enough to say this person requires a referral for mental health counseling or any kind of counseling or any community resource. But, you know, we live busy lives, and doctors aren't necessarily attuned to, they're busy taking care of the physiological needs, and sometimes the emotional needs get, again, put on the shelf. And what we're finding is that for ethnic minorities in the United States, there's less likely to be a referral for counseling than there is for whites or Western Europeans in the United States. Also, when we do, African Americans tend to be overrepresented in emergency rooms and psychiatric hospitals. So what's happening there is that you have somebody who is emotionally distressed, and it's gone on way too long, and so their first attempt or intervention to deal with the distress is in a psychiatric hospital or emergency room, and that's never good. When we look at American Indians or Alaska Natives, there is so little research in terms of mental health service and utilization rates. But what we do know is that 25% live in poverty and 20% lack insurance. And while they're less likely to die from cancer and heart disease than whites, the population is 5 to 6 times more likely to die from alcohol-related causes. And suicide rate is 50% higher than the national average. So again, we're looking at ways where psychosocial interventions could be extremely helpful if they were accessible and available to particular populations. And now we're talking about this in general at a diagnosis of cancer, and you can see how the problem becomes ever more complicated and difficult. When we look at Asian Americans in the United States, I mean, it's a misnomer to group them all together. It doesn't do justice to the group as a whole, because there are at least 43 separate ethnic groups that make up this category. And while the income is similar to whites, and you're looking at educational attainment rates that may be similar, there's a lot of diversity within and across these groups. So it's not an equal comparison to look at the group as a whole. But what we do know, again, is that 21% lack health insurance, and that even with this educational attainment rate and with higher income, you're seeing half have problems with access to mental health services because of the limited English proficiency. When we look at Hispanic Americans or Latinos in the United States, again, it's probably not as diverse as Asian cultures, maybe I think about 23 separate republics. We're looking at 27% living in poverty, and 40% of Hispanics report being unable to speak English well, again, limiting access to mental health services. Makes me think back to the time when I was in graduate school in Pullman, Washington, getting my doctorate degree in clinical psychology, and I remember that I was the only Spanish-speaking therapist within an hour and a half radius, and they needed somebody experienced. I was just a graduate student back then, but it really made me think about the significant need there is in being able to provide services to diverse cultures and linguistically diverse cultures. Well, so what am I talking about when I talk about culture? We talked about the ethnic and racial diversity is a little bit clearer for us to see, but when we're talking about culture in general is defined as a set of socially transmitted values, beliefs, traditions, and behaviors shared by a group. And these can be specific to that particular group, how they look at the world, their worldview. And that will influence access to mental health services. Cultural and linguistic factors may influence utilization rates as well. So your ability to communicate with your provider is very important and when you're deciding whether to access it and to continue counseling. I'm going to talk a little bit more specifically about how culture can influence access to care. And this is aside from the economic and the insurance issue. So let's just say you had somebody who had insurance and could even speak English well. When you look at different cultures, each one has its own perspective on what mental health is, and that attitude itself can become an obstacle to care. It can also be an asset, depending upon how you look at it. In general, our society, doesn't matter what background you come from, we seem to share a stigma or shame associated with mental illness as if it's something somebody's done on purpose, where it becomes an embarrassment maybe to the family, and the person, him or herself, is afraid to reach out and get help because they're ashamed. We don't reinforce the idea that we can say we're not feeling well emotionally. I don't think there's a place yet in our society where we can openly talk about that. It's something that you do secretly and privately, and you don't necessarily share that with people around you. Depending upon the culture and the degree of privacy, some cultures find it very hard to talk to people outside of their family in terms of what's going on internally to them. So privacy factors, I mean, you just don't air your dirty laundry with strangers. And also your ability to disclose to somebody you don't know very well is it's hard. It's hard for all of us. It's particularly hard for very private cultures who are used to dealing with problems within their own families. Our mental health care system is not necessarily set up to, it doesn't accommodate many cultural styles very well. And I guess the best way I can explain that, if you look at any of you who are doing service work, when you're helping people, you generally do some kind of intake where you're asking a bunch of very personal questions. And for many individuals, it's such a significant invasion of privacy that it's hard to open up, honestly. It's a very frightening experience for someone to come in to get help and then to be asked questions about their sex life. Also, our physical exams that we give in medical setting, issues of modesty and and humility and those things make it very difficult for people to feel comfortable in that process so that they can share fully what's going on inside of them. There's a general sense of mistrust from many diverse cultures in the United States, and some of that has to do with, I think, I'll give you my thoughts on it in a couple of ways. One is the historical experience of these cultural groups in the United States that leads to a natural distrust to people who are in authority or professionals. That trust hasn't been developed because of historical challenges that have been experienced by these ethnic groups in the United States. And I wish we had time to talk more about that, but I think you guys get a general idea of what I'm saying. And also our society tends to be very practical, with our health maintenance organizations, it has to be very efficient, and there's not a lot of room for a respect for the person, I guess is what I want to say. And in many cultures, particularly collectivistic cultures, we need to approach each other as human beings first, and then the business at hand comes second. So you need to see me as an individual before you ask me for my copayment. In many collectivistic cultures, payment for healthcare services you pay after. You don't pay up front. It just seems to me that many, in my experience in working with diverse groups, there's a sense that in the United States, our healthcare system is very money-oriented and less healthcare or person-oriented. And that's just in general. Of course, case by case, and different agencies and different practitioners have their own styles, but in general, there's a sense that that patients aren't cared about other than what they can pay. Also, when you look at different cultures, their perceived understanding of the causes of illnesses is very important. So if they believe that, and again, I don't mean to be stereotypical, but in many traditional cultures, I mean, if you believe in things like karma or a punishment for, one's sins, or, a relative, an ancestor has done something, and now the consequence is in the mental illness or behavioral problem of someone in that lineage. So depending upon your belief and the understanding of the cause of illness, that's going to really, it could potentially hinder access and utilization of mental health services. And I'm probably not doing a good job, but I mean, it could be something as basic as understanding the etiology, a person's etiology of where they got that disorder. So I remember reading about a case once of an individual who had a significant depression. And if you asked her what her belief was, she believed that it was her ex-husband who was haunting her. And, I'm not here to counter that, but if you understand that that's where she believes her illness is coming from, then you have to look at it from that perspective in order to help them move forward from that. So people have different understandings as to why they're ill, either physically or emotionally, and it's really important to take that into account. And simple things like, cultural values, one's spirituality and religion also play a part into whether or not they're going to get mental health services and whether or not they'll utilize them in a way that's helpful to them. So if you believe that it's God's will, as is the case with fatalism, that God has predetermined that you will be ill and there's really nothing you can do about it, that you shouldn't challenge God's will, then you're less likely to get care for yourself or believe that you can challenge it. Your spirituality and religion can overlap with that fatalism, but also can be an asset for people in instilling hope and helping them get through a difficult process. But in our traditional mental health or counseling, we don't generally integrate spirituality or religion into that care, and it's so important because more people than not are spiritual and have a faith that could help them get through this process. People's traditional roles and the role of the family will also influence whether or not they'll get help. And in just basic ways, so if you're so busy fulfilling your role, let's just say a gender role, and let me be stereotypical here, if you are a man who is, ill but still has to work, how are you going to incorporate getting help? If going to get help is going to take away from your responsibilities within your family role, you're not going to do that. You're going to sacrifice yourself for the sake of the family. Same thing, I'm going to be stereotypical again. Let's just say you have a mother who is ill at home. In lieu of going to get help, she's going to if time is limited, which it generally is for all of us, she's going to try to fulfill her duties best as she can, and again, sacrifice herself for the sake of the family, and that's part of familialism. The family is involved in the treatment planning. The family is involved in, you know, taking the patient to the doctor's office. It's not uncommon for a room to be filled with family members in as part of the treatment. There's probably no such thing as HIPAA in terms of family. They wouldn't necessarily agree with the rights of privacy for the patient, that they feel that there's a sense of entitlement for them to know what's going on with their loved one, and that's culturally based as well. And you know, something basic as, let's just say there's bad news that needs to be told. In some cultures, it would be completely inappropriate to share that bad news directly with the patient, that you would share that with a family member and then have that family member share that. But how are you supposed to know that, right? And that's part of the practicing cultural competence. In order for you to know how to appropriately deal with a particular ethnicity, that would require an immense amount of reading and familiarity with cultures. There is a good reference out there that I didn't put in the book, and I want to briefly state. It's called Ethnicity and Family Therapy. One of the editors is Monica McGoldrick, and I'm sorry I'm rushing through that, but she does a wonderful job of putting together authors from within cultures that are across the United States. It gives you great insight into how different cultures view the world, including mental health and their access to mental health and how they view that. And it ranges from African-American Muslims to Pakistani to El Salvadorians to Germans. It's just a really great book to look at some of the nuances within the culture. But I think what's more important as you're trying to understand the ethnic and cultural demographics of patients is to immerse yourself in different cultures. And I have that further down as a bullet here, but to really open yourself up to the opportunity of learning that people don't always see the world the way that you do. If you try to memorize all the facts from different cultures, it's really it's an effort that you'll never accomplish. But if you can create for yourself a template and an understanding that people may see the world differently than I do, they may see their illness differently than I do, and they may see how they should be cared for differently than I do. That's the beginning part, to be open and to be able to learn from individuals in that culture by interacting with them, not avoiding differences. Basic things like translating information, not just literal translations, because some things don't translate very well and can be very confusing. You know, words like disease and infection. I know that there was some discussion when AIDS information came out, and describing it as an infection then meant that there could be perhaps an antibiotic that could cure that. And also, you need to take into account people's reading levels. And so translating information may mean in ways other than just the written literal translation. I can't say enough about hiring bilingual staff. Using interpreters is, you know, second up there to hiring bilingual staff, but if that's what's required, then to absolutely integrate that best as you can, and recruiting and retaining minority staff. An office, a community center becomes way more accessible and approachable when people can see themselves in the helpers there. As I talked to you before about that cultural divide between practitioner and patient, or community member who's providing a service and the community member him or herself, they're way more likely to approach somebody that they can identify with. And that is probably one of the best bridges to getting people to get help, is for them to see themselves in that agency, somebody like themselves. Continuing with the integration of cultural training, it's just not a one-stop shop. It's continuous. It should be in all aspects of training. Being able to look at the idea that people may see the world differently than I do is very important, and the more information you get from different cultures about that, the more sensitive you are going to be. You're not going to have all the answers, but you're going to be sensitized in a situation where you can ask yourself, could this be a cultural issue that I may not know about but could be present? When appropriate, coordinating with traditional healers to provide a more holistic care for the patient is appropriate. Use of community health workers. You all know probably about the success of looking at peer support groups and cancer survivors, and how effective that can be in bringing people in and providing that emotional support and sometimes better than individual counseling. Providing culturally congruent health promotion. I'll take just a quick minute to talk about that. And again, I'm going to reference the when people were talking about AIDS prevention and promoting safe practices. When you're looking at collectivistic cultures, like more people on the planet come from collectivistic cultures, meaning that they look at themselves in terms of relations with others. Here in the United States, we tend to be very individualistic, that we look at our own, the pros and cons for ourselves in terms of making actions about ourselves and our health care. In collectivistic cultures, you can approach that in terms of, when I say culturally congruent, here's an example. If you're looking at women who you're trying to increase monthly breast exams, so there could be some literature promotion out there saying, you know, in order to extend your life, in order to prevent, you know, to catch cancer early for yourself, you know, to live a long and healthy life, you need to do monthly breast exams. And that could be effective for some, but probably what would be more effective for women from collectivistic cultures would be to talk about, it seems almost manipulative, but it tends to be more effective, is to be able to say, what will your family do without you if you're not around? One way of being around, you know, increasing your chances of being around longer is to conduct monthly breast exams. You see the approach is a little bit different there. We've talked about a family-centered model in terms of treatment, that excluding family members from that process can be quite hurtful, and it leaves the patient feeling alienated and isolated. For people, again, from collectivistic cultures, immersing yourself in cultures is probably one of the best ways to learn about those nuances and to sensitize yourself. And I guess if I were to give you any message in terms of how to better be responsive to the needs of diverse populations and patients in particular, and we all work so hard, all of you who have dialed in today care, and you want your care not to go to waste, and you want to be as effective and as helpful as you can be in providing these services. And the best thing you can do is to learn about different cultures and create that sensitivity in yourself so that if someone were to come from the moon, you'd be able to say, I wonder if that it may have to do with moon culture, even if you don't know what moon culture is about. And that in and of itself will be helpful. It will make you a more respectful helper, and you'll have more credibility in terms of the person you're trying to help. So cultural immersion, going to activities, probably the best place I can recommend you guys go. Go to a grocery store, one that is so far removed from your culture, and just watch. See what they're eating and see the people engaging and interacting. Other things that one can do, organizational accommodations, looking at your hours of service. Are you meeting the needs of the people who are working all day? You know, is there a bus route available? Are the outreach efforts, as we talked about before, are you reaching out to the community in a way that's meaningful to them? I brushed through so much of this, and I know that we're limited on time. But again, as I said before, I wanted to sensitize you to this topic. There are no absolute problem-solving answers here to you, and I wanted to share with you that for me this is something that's really important and highly personal. I do a mental health cross-cultural mental health trainings for, you know, practitioners a lot. But for me, I've lived it. I grew up with a mother who was diagnosed with schizophrenia back in the 60s when I was, you know, very little. And I feel like I've lost her twice. I lost her to mental illness, and she's of Mexican descent, very traditional Mexican descent. And then I lost her again at way too early age. She was 69. You know, my grandmother and great-grandmother had lived to 100 because of chronic disease, of diabetes and high blood pressure and high levels of cholesterol. And she was not somebody who was willing, didn't feel that mental health services were something that were helpful or meaningful to her. A lot of that had to do with the types of treatment that she received when I was very young in the 60s. And there wasn't a lot of cross-cultural understanding, and she didn't speak English very well, and I felt that it really turned her off. And so I guess what I'm trying to say to you is that I appreciate all of you who have called in, that if we all take a little bit more time to think about where culture can, and ethnicity and lower socioeconomic status can influence the care that we give, that by even planting that seed, I think that's a great beginning. And I thank you all for your patience with all the technical problems here. Charlene, I've got the slide up here, and I think that we are open to a few questions. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Kathy. That was a wonderful presentation. We do have, we are at the end, but we would like to allow for some questions. If you do look on your chat, on your webinar form, there is a chat window where you can submit questions. If we do have any questions, please submit them through that. Otherwise, you can submit questions to the email address that you can see on your screen right now. I think we'll just, Kathy, right now it looks like we haven't had any questions. I think people are probably just really engrossed in what you're saying. I will pass this on to Ashley Johnson. Ashley, sure. Are you there?
Yes. Can you hear me? Hello.
Hi, Ashley. Do you want to wait around for a while?
Sure.
Great. We'll just be waiting just for a few minutes. Please feel free to submit any questions.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us. We will be sending a recording of the webinar within the next few days. Thank you again.